Entertain a motion. There's a lot on the consent agenda here with the finances, the warrants. Someone wants to make a motion about that and the minutes.
So moved.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we'll jump right into administrative report. Jerry, you're on the end.
Sure. I will start. I do have a information report for you. First of all, welcome back and welcome to Old Roads. Nice to have everybody. I'll wait till it gets around.
Mark, do you want to pass yours around and say
yeah, it's on its way.
So I don't put out as much, or I don't have as much information about enrollment as we do at, throughout the year, but we closed last year with 125. We opened last year with 118 students. We closed with 125. We're starting this year with 124 as of right now. So of course things, Andy, Mark, Mary, and myself all just met with more registrations, so that number could change. But I did add, as of what I do know, there are a few student numbers are around DCF custody. So I did include our student numbers right now for kindergarten, first through sixth grade. But I did want you to see new enrolled from. So you can see that we had students from California, Florida. We had a transfer from Green Street and also a transfer in from Hilltop. We also had students that a family that moved down to Florida. That was a transfer out. Family that is moving to private school, Putney Grammar. One going transfer over to Academy, Arkansas, and again, sixth grader going to Hilltop. So,
what is ODP under other
things? That's an out of district placement. So a student who is our student but won't be starting the year with us. New staff is listed. Right now, Sandy Stockton has been working quite a bit this summer. She's our new BCBA. She'll be running our STEP program. She's from Keene. Galen Kemp, I brought her to the board last year. She is going to be our grade 2 teacher. Joe Garrison, I heard he's coming from Illinois. First time to Vermont. I asked him, you know, why Vermont, and he was like, almost like, why not? So, I'm really excited to have him. He hasn't arrived to Vermont yet. He just finished. He's been working with the summer student conservation group down in the Delaware Water Gap, and so he's due to arrive sometime this weekend. Tracy Murphy is an Oak Grove alum and a Brattleboro high school alum, and she's going to be joining us in grade 3 as a para. Allison Paquette, we kind of stole her, if you will. She's from early ed services. Molly Goldblum is new again to Vermont. She's been working in Vermont at camps, summer camps, originally from Connecticut. So she's going to be here for a year. Megan Gray was just hired this past week. She will be our new HCRS clinician. And we did have a very late last week resignation for our intensive special educator. for grades 4 to 6. So that position at this time is still open, and we are actively searching for a special educator to fill that position. Some of our PD work that we're going to be doing starting tomorrow, it's coming right up. So in the morning, we'll be spending time looking at Eureka Math, the new math curriculum, and then moving into talking about STEP, what STEP is going to look like here at Oak Grove and how it ties into our work with PBIS. Later on in the year, we'll be joining up, I would assume, with Green Street to do some more work with our Reading Street collaboration. And
with what collaboration?
Oh, with Reading Street, the Reading Street curriculum. Just a couple of upcoming events for you to see. Our back-to-school celebration is Tuesday, opening day. We still run a half-day schedule with parent workshops and a lot of community involvement on that morning. Oak Grove Open House is scheduled for September 22nd. And on the back side are the different summer projects. I put the kindergarten ceiling and insulation in there. It was actually part of the 2015-16 budget, but it was completed right at the end of the school year. Once SCAMP kindergarten got out, SCAMP got through, then they were able to get in there and finish that up. Student bathrooms, I would love to show you the student bathrooms whenever you want to see them. They are, we're
really
very,
nice.
Very proud. Greg Greg Frost did a lot of work. We also contracted out for plumbing, electric, flooring with Lawton Flooring. So it's from ceiling all the way down to the flooring, brand new plumbing, a lot of plumbing you can imagine. Once they got inside there, realized that it was pretty bad. So probably a little bit more in the plumbing department than we were expecting, but it looks, it's great, it's beautiful. A lot of things done different in the grounds. Our ground, just so you're aware, our ground budget is probably, we're gonna be going over a little. We found that over the years, every year we have the mulch, they come in and they spray our playground, they spray the mulch, and this, it's just has gotten so packed down that now the timbers that kind of divide up the playground, even if they come in with a nice thin layer of mulch, it was still creating too much of a trip hazards, and so they actually had to bring in some fill and then did a lot more mulch. So it's a little higher, more expense than it was last year, so we'll just have, we're hoping for a light snow season so we can kind of balance that out like we did last year. And then there's just a few other things. So a lot was happening this year, and it's amazing. A week ago, I was kind of shaking my head like, this is never going to happen. And here we are. That's it. Thank you.
I believe my report has worked its way around. just placed two more kids about 15 minutes ago, so I think we're up to 229. Like Jerry said, that is subject to change throughout this first week of school. Sometimes kids you have on your list don't show up, and sometimes people show up that you weren't expecting. So we'll see how it goes. But I believe that number is up from last year. I think we were hovered around 222-ish throughout the year last year. So down a little bit shows where these new students are coming from. Really all over the map here. Washington State, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, Massachusetts. And then we've also had not as many students transfer out that we know of so far, but a list of those students as well, grades and where they're going, right there. In terms of professional development, as we welcome staff back tomorrow, very similar to what Jerry described for Oak Grove, we'll be doing a math professional development day tomorrow. We started using Engage New York last year, full school, full year implementation. So we're headed into year two. This year we bought the program. So Engage New York is packaged as Eureka Math, but it's essentially the exact same curriculum we taught last year. So we're excited about year two. implementation. Mary Kaufman, our sixth grade teacher, is going to help lead the professional development tomorrow. So she's put some nice work into that over the past couple of weeks. Back page. Under student programming, we don't have much there, but what we're going to be trying to do over the next 3 to 4 weeks is develop kind of a year-long scope and sequence of what our after-school enrichment program looks like, so that in October, when we'll hand out a pamphlet to every family, and they'll be able to see what it is that we offer throughout the entire school year. So it'll help with families picking and choosing what it is they want to participate in throughout the year. That'll be coming together, and I'll share probably second meeting in September. Some school-wide events coming up. Monday, August 29th, we always have an open house from 2 to 3 o'clock for all new students to the school. And they typically take us up on that. So we'll be inviting new families to come check out their classrooms, meet the teacher, get a sense of the layout of the building before that first day on Tuesday. Tuesday, it is a full day school for us, which we went back to last year. Previously, we had done the half day celebration. So it is a full day for Green Street. Kindergarten students will be half day for 2 weeks. September 12th will be the first full day for them. Working our way down the list here, our open house, which will be a Green Street School family cookout, will be held on September 28th. So just dates to keep in mind. School Sing this year will not be starting in September. We have a new music teacher, Julie Ackerman-Hovis, and just feel like it's not fair to throw her in front of the entire school community that first week of school. Give her some time to build a repertoire with the kids. So hopefully that first Thursday in October, we'll unveil our first school sing of the year. Down to facility updates, it's been a really crazy busy summer at Green Street School. We've run into a lot of issues, but we've been fixing a lot of things, but a lot of unexpected costs. We had a collapsed ceiling in our air handler room, which is we are working on right now. It won't delay us for school, but that's certainly going to be an unexpected cost, but it's something that absolutely has to be done. Over the summer, we had a dumpster fire where smoke came into the building, and our fire panel failed. So we actually didn't get a fire alarm during that dumpster fire. I was there at 1 o'clock in the morning with my new head custodian, and so it was scary. We had smoke in the hallways and no alarms, but luckily we had a phone call from a neighbor. So that was in the beginning of August, second week of August, I believe that happened. So that has led to a total emergency repair situation. I took a picture of my office today, sent it to my wife. It looks like spaghetti hanging from the ceilings. It's just, wires everywhere, or like 3 or 4 guys in there working to get it done. But we will be ready for Friday, I believe. Hopefully they will be out of there. So also other plumbing issues we came across as well. So quite a few unexpected costs, but I feel good. Got those taken care of. A lot of nice things we worked on this summer, landscaping improvements to the side and front of the building, another new playground structure, which the students are gonna be excited about. Our basement was filled with stuff. We had a total basement transformation this summer. New head custodian, Eugene Frost and Ron Howe, just did a tremendous amount of work and organizing, and we feel like we've developed a building with much better organization and storage capabilities. So we're in a really good position moving forward. All of our hallway carpets were replaced. Some new technology upgrades, art room projector, smart board, music room projector, sound system. In our gymnasium, we've added a motorized screen, an audio sound system, video system. So that'll enhance our school sings and add another layer of dynamic to phys ed program. And we've also, we're in the process of having our gym floor refinished, so re-sanded down, recoded, and then new lines. We're going to put the Green Street School logo in the center court. So working with a company out of Quincy, Mass, they have been delaying us throughout the summer. It's been very frustrating. They do great work, but at this point, they'll probably be working into the first week of school, and hopefully we'll be ready to go after Labor Day, but that's been frustrating. And one thing I do fear, if you get complaints, is the smell in our building for that first year, first week. So we're going to do everything we can to push that air out of the back of the building, but I know it's going to be, we're going to have fumes, so that'll lead to some complaints, I'm sure.
Mark, the emails that we'd all gotten about the fence, you want to address that?
Yep, and I think I put that on there for some safety improvements to our playground. So if you're not familiar with Green Street Playground, we're fenced in on the back, but there is a big entrance that connects us to Beach Street. So throughout the year last year, and many years before, we would be on the playground, and people just walk through our playground. So it was just a walking pathway. So we had a couple instances last year where we had some folks walk through who we didn't want on our playground, stumbling across the back playground, smelling of alcohol. And paras complained about supervision, just feeling like it wasn't a safe thing. We have lots of families where issues with families, custody issues. So having adults kind of walk through our playground just created some issues. So we plan in the summer to install a fence so that we could lock that gate during a school day. As word got out into the community around Green Street, turned into quite the dramatic, kind of a little drama thing here. But some letters to the editor, I believe, emails to Ron, school board members, select board members, I believe even. I've done my best to reach out to each one of those people who have made a complaint. And 100% of the people who I've actually spoken to and have showed them what we're planning on doing felt like it's a good thing and it makes sense. But there still may be some folks out there who disagree. Bottom line, I think it's a safety issue, and I think it's something we need to do for our staff and students. Outside of the school day, that gate will be open. We want the community to use the playground, just like all schools. But during the school day, I feel like it is another classroom for our students, and don't feel like we need to have people come through.
What was the road that they were concerned in the back? Is it Beach or
Beach Street?
Beach Street. And I think that's the key, that there will be a gate for the Beach Street residents, their students, to be able to come up through that gate. And I think the initial concern was that you're closing it right off from that community, and that's not the case. So I think Mark has made a good point of clearing that up for those parents.
There's some misinformation. I think a neighbor got information from a landscaper who then went and shared it with everybody, but it was not accurate in terms of the plans that we had for that fence. So I welcome a conversation with anyone else who wants to discuss it, but I think it's pretty clear cut, and I think it makes sense.
Thank you for putting a fence up and protecting staff and students.
Yes.
The best thing to do, and that's just the way it is.
Yeah, I feel strongly about that too.
So our report should be in front of you, but not. We didn't do it.
It should be.
But you're not here.
It should be, but it's not.
So actually, didn't think we would do a report for this meeting, so, but I can summarize what would be in the report. So this student enrollment is very fluid right now. I mean, we just met and enrolled four or five kids today. We took in several last week. In the next week to 10 days, we'll take in quite a few kids. We'll meet continuously to process the applications, registration information, and then place the students accordingly. And if they're new to the community, just so you know, because the process we use is, at this point, we really have to look at low numbers in a class. So if a student lives closest to, let's say, Green Street, but if it's in a particular grade and they're high, but Oak Grove or Academy is low, the student will typically be moved to the school with the lowest number or a low number. We also try to keep in mind, we don't want to put kids on buses if we can avoid it, but we enrolled a student, a couple students, hey, for example, now where they went, they're going to be on a bus, we had to go with the lowest, you know, low number. So we'll continue to do that as the next several days will be quite a few students enrolling. And usually on the first day, we get quite a few parents walking in to register their kids right at the school. You may have seen either by email or the banner downtown, the town school banner that now hangs from Sunday to Sunday at Main Street across where Duo is on the corner. We wanted to do something to do things that continually promote the schools in the community, and that seems to be a prime spot. So we hung the banner. To my surprise, it costs $150 a week to hang the banner there. I thought that being a town entity, that the fee was waived. It's not. We'd like to hang the banner probably three times throughout the course of the year. Mark also has his Tulip Trot banner, which he'd probably hang three or four times. So I would like to formally ask the board to write a letter to either the select board or the town manager to request a waiver of the fee for us, so we can hang the banner several times a year and have that fee waived. In lieu of a couple of things. One, when we gave the town, you gave the town the fire station lot, you may call it that one, I asked for future consideration. I would consider this to be part of that. And also, I mean, we donate quite a bit of things to the town. I mean, the space at Academy, for example, for all the town rep meetings, we don't charge. If they go to BUHS as a charge, I've always waived that fee for the town, and I think that's just part of being a citizen in the town. The school should work with the town. So at this point, I would ask you to write a letter asking that be reciprocated, and that the schools could enjoy, could use that space several times a year.
For free. The school district also shared the cost of the traffic control devices at Academy, the speed indicator and the walk-through crossing lights. So I think that's a very reasonable thing to ask.
So would you like to make that a motion that you would write that letter?
So moved. I don't know if I should.
I will.
I'm going to get the letter as well.
So I'll move that we write the letter to the town and maybe point out some of these moments to them.
Second.
Any discussion on that one?
Are you clear on what all these things are? Like, could you send an email with these kinds of things that you feel like we've done, just unless you have them all?
Well, he isn't even naming all the ones that come into my head. But, okay. There's...
Well, I don't know if it needs a bumper.
Could it be like...
But it's just, in general, I think that the schools do try to work with the town on a lot of different things, and posting and allowing rec groups to come through and use the space as well, so...
Yeah, it's a fire department task, and they generally charge for those kinds of things, but they're not, I don't think they're in a position to waive it, but the select board certainly could. Let's take the land back.
So it's a letter to the town re-waiving the banner
asking for a removal or waiver of the fee for the banner hanging.
Okay.
In consideration of different things the schools give to the town. That's the gist of your motion there, Mark?
That sounds good. Well, I would have had other language, but being Governor General, I'll go with that.
Well, they didn't do it to us. I mean, that's their policy.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that they created a policy for us. That's their policy, and so of course, we want to have it hung, or Mark goes to have the tulip truck banner hung. That's what the policy calls for. So they wrote the policy with everyone in mind who'd like to use it, and we're asking them to waive the fee for us as well.
So any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
I better abstain, just because I don't know what I should.
Duly noted, right, Jane?
So, I want to just make the board aware that it's a very nice thing, a very good thing. We have, last year we had a student at Academy School who was deaf. She came in as a kindergartner, and it required us to hire a communication facilitator. And a communication facilitator is a person who translates like the spoken word into sign. And this student did not know sign language. So we had to also teach her sign. And the communication facilitator also has the ability to help the student to communicate. So she has special training. And very, very successful with this student. And one of the things we did in the kindergarten class is we taught all the kids in the class sign language. Because one of the frustrations this youngster was having was that she could not communicate with her peers. She can't speak, she can't hear, and she did not know how to sign. But it didn't do her a lot of good that she still couldn't communicate with other kids. So we taught the kids in the class. And also, her IEP called for a teacher of the deaf, which we were unable to hire, but we actually got someone part-time from the high school. So based on that success, there's another youngster in our community who is also deaf, who's coming into kindergarten this year. So for this school year, we're going to have a first grader and a second grader. And we've been fortunate enough to be able to hire a teacher of the deaf. The lady was at the high school, no longer needed there, so we will have her employed with us full time. So it's wonderful that we can offer this, because if we weren't successful, the only program for these two youngsters would be out of the community, would be either Northampton, Mass, or Hartford, Connecticut, which would mean they'd have to actually be living there. So it's a wonderful thing we can do, and I'm just so proud of our teachers that they're able to do that and successfully. But now the problem becomes with hiring a teacher that's deaf. She needs a space to meet with these children, and if you know our at Academy right now, we don't have any space. So we have been looking at space throughout the summer, trying to figure out how to create a space for them. And we've done that. We're going to actually create a space where there's one in a corridor, and we'll be constructing that. It's not done yet. We still don't have the approval of the state fire marshal to do it. We anticipate that we'll get that in the next few days, and within 2 weeks we'll have a space for this teacher and her two students. Of course, there's a cost to that, and we're working on that. But so probably the next time that you're at Academy, you'll see at the end of the wing on the right, when you come down the hallway, where the original building ends and the 70s edition begins with the brick wall there, where the third grade classrooms begin. We're right in that corner. We're actually constructing a small, very small classroom.
Will this teacher work with the other students as well, like you said?
She'll be in the classroom on some occasions, but the bulk of her work will be working with these two kids, either one-on-one, and some occasions she'll have both of them in there. So, but both kids will still spend a significant amount of time in their classroom with their peers. Receiving instruction. They need specialized instruction that goes beyond what a classroom teacher can do. So last year when she came down for the child who was in kindergarten, she worked individually with her. We didn't have a space, so she would be in the corner of the classroom. But she did take her away from the other kids in that space.
But she worked with the kids on signing too? So.
Well, she didn't do the sign language, but the communication facilitator who is full-time at Academy did that. So she is in the classroom with the child all day long. If the student goes to art, she goes with her, goes to gym, she goes with her. So now we'll have two communication facilitators, one for each child, and then the teacher of the deaf.
That's great. I love the idea for peers learning and
integrating
her being
able to. It's amazing going to the classroom and see the kindergarten is signing. It's very touching. The 29th, that's Monday, have a meet and greet. We do invite all of our students and their parents to come and meet their classroom teacher. That's on Monday at 2. We are still hiring. We're looking for two parents, okay? Full-time special ed para for half a year due to legal maternity leave, and then we need a half-time classroom para that's all year. We're still looking for those folks. And our in-service, actually tomorrow morning, we have a presenter by the name of Grace Dearborn coming, and she's doing brain-based engagement strategies. It's really high energy, very active, fun, upbeat presentation that she'll do with lots of movement. And all the things that she'll do with us are things that teachers can and will be doing with their students in the classroom. And our back to school night, I think all three are on the 22nd of September.
We're the 28th.
Okay.
That's your back to school night? So I had two quick questions then, just to make sure I'm clear. There's a half a day kindergarten for 2 weeks, Mark mentioned. Is that the same schedule for all the kindergartners in our mm-hmm. schools? And then we're a half day only at Oak Grove, full day first day of school.
Mm-hmm.
And the last question would be, are the numbers, I know they're fluctuating, but are they essentially balanced? Is there anything you're concerned about that we suddenly have too many sixth graders to be accommodated or whatever?
Right now we're good. It's been a very fluid summer. We've lost a lot of students, have moved, a lot have come in. Truancy rate seems to be increasing. Just a lot of students this summer. And then many of them moved far away.
Well, two of our families, family that they had two children here, and went back to Florida. The father worked on the bridge project. And then another one of our students, they were transferred down to Arkansas because of the nuclear energy. So some of them are, like Andy was saying, some transient, but some are also transfers for businesses, jobs.
And the other thing of note, I think all three schools that beginning first day of school, all of our students will be able to eat a free breakfast or free lunch.
Yes.
That none of our students will be charged for either meal any longer. It's the CEP, what's it stand for? I can't remember. CEP, certified.
But that's
the certified number. So
every Brattleboro child can now eat lunch and breakfast without cost?
Right.
Yes. Well, but that's just the elementary schools.
Yes.
Right.
K-6, yes.
So there's no more lunch payments that any of us do?
No more what?
None of us pay for it, or you can if you apply?
No one pays for it. Lunch is free for all of our students, regardless of their socioeconomic status.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thinking of my pocketbook, yeah. Writing a check for my child.
You can still run a check, care of Academy School if you like.
I've written a lot of those.
For the banner program.
Okay, so Ron, I'm going to pass it to you, but I want to note that my schedule had us starting the next thing at 3:30.
Yes, that is very tight.
I didn't really expect a lot of noteworthy accomplishments from the principals when we have it at school.
So I'm going to turn my time over to Lyle, and I do have some items within the next couple of agenda sections.
So we'll let you turn.
Thanks. So Monday, August 22nd, is the day where curriculum and assessment office start really up and running. So Monday was a training for all substitutes in WSASU, and every substitute is sent through mail an invitation to come to the training, where we review procedures, confidentiality, student medications, their own medications, things that they should know when they're going to sub. So that was Monday. Tuesday is our new hires, was our new hires breakfast. We do it at the Hideaway. Jean Gilbert takes care of the food. We try to make it very nice with flowers and tablecloths and linen napkins, and it's really quite quite beautiful. But all new hires to WSESU and their mentor or their buddy are invited to that breakfast. After that breakfast, I usually work with the mentors for a while, and we provide the bloodborne and hazardous material training that's required for all of our employees. So that was Tuesday. Today was the new para training. New paras also are required to have the hazmat and bloodborne training. New paras, all paras, no matter their education, must put together a para portfolio to show their highly qualified they are for their job. So we reviewed that. And additionally, all new teachers had a training day today on all the programs that we use in WSESU. So how to access substitute subs online, AmesWeb, PowerSchool, where we take attendance for everyone. We had Karen Tronofsky from BUHS come in and talk about Google Classroom and how we use Google Classroom. Gary Parzyk talked about the new WSESU employee portal. So all new hires had another training day today. And then, as was mentioned earlier, tomorrow is our first day back with all teachers in Paris. We have professional development at all our sites, not just Brattleboro. And then Friday, every teacher in WSESU comes together. And Ron, Paul, myself have a chance to talk a little bit. So that's this week. Goes by really fast, but I'll tell you, prepping for this week gets to be a little crazy.
And students come back on Tuesday. And
students come on Tuesday.
You know. Well, we're getting down to committee reports.
If you.
Yeah, mine is under the diversity.
Okay.
Just an announcement that on September 29th, the diversity committee. Michaela Sims, our coordinator, is organizing a dinner primarily for students and families of color. It's sponsored by the AWARE group, and that's a student group that promotes diversity. And so we've had one or two of these each year. So the schools all know September 29th is not a date to do open houses or other activities. As we get closer to that, I'll give you a little bit more about the agenda. But it's really a chance for to reach out to parents, to build community, learn more about the district, share connections across the grade levels, and discuss some of the successes and challenges that they have as parents. So it's a nice activity. I'll talk more about that as we get closer to it.
Any other committee reports? Does anyone know where Deb is? There hasn't been a policy council meeting lately.
We had one. We just had new hirings and things like that. So
I know the grant came through.
Yes.
I saw that. Energy committee. I don't think you guys are meeting at the moment, right?
Nothing's going on.
And finance. Mark, anything? Any meeting lately on that?
No.
Meeting tomorrow?
12 o'clock.
5:00.
5:00. Yes, we have a meeting tomorrow, 5:00.
All right. Moving on to unfinished.
Sure, quick. This one, WCSU finance.
Finance. Was there a big meeting on that capital grants review?
Now, that finance is going to be at the regional career center prior to the Act 46 meeting.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yep.
Yeah, good.
Okay, so that moves us to the superintendent search process.
Yeah, so under unfinished business, the update on the superintendent search process. As I talked to you in June, and I met with all the boards in May and June. Prior to that, I had met with the SU, the Supervisory Union and Finance Committee, because they're the compensation and evaluation committee that works with the superintendent. So reviewed the concept of an internal process, search process, at that time with each board. I had talked to you, along with other boards, about the Vermont Superintendents Association advice about the internal search process, with 30% of the superintendencies changing every year. They felt strongly that if you have an internal process, that would be a good way to at least start the process. I returned back to the SU Finance Committee at the end of June when they had their last meeting and just confirmed, and with their agreement, this first phase to consider an internal candidate or candidates. We'd be looking at that probably, well, through mid-September, through the end of October, possibly the beginning of November. We'll be setting up focus groups. The SU Finance Committee or certain board members that are available would serve as essentially the screening committee. The focus groups would include teachers and staff members. We would have community members as part of our service partners that work closely with our district. Parents would be part of that group. We will have our administrative leadership group as a focus group, and we will have the central office as a focus group, the central office staff that works pretty closely with the superintendent. So I think going through that process, essentially interviewing with all of those focus groups, and then bringing it back to the SU Finance, again, probably the end of October, to get a sense of, so, you know, is the internal process what we want to stick with, or do we want to do something different?
So when you say the internal process, that means we're actually looking at a candidate internally, or we're talking about the process?
We've posted it internally. So the closing deadline is September 2nd. We'll have a sense of who responds. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And so then we would interview anybody that responds internally before we post it externally?
Yes.
That's the process. Is there any questions from the board on that? Okay. I can't see people very well in this setup, sir.
I just didn't know about the timing. I remember we talked about being able to look both internally and mm-hmm. externally, right. And like I imagine those processes were happening at the same time, but I don't know. It's such a long timetable.
No, I mean, it's for next year, finishing this year. So I think if we finish the first phase in November, we have plenty of time if we need to do something else.
But at that November, the end of October time, that wouldn't necessarily mean that internal candidates had been ruled out.
Right.
If we go on to look at external candidates, it might mean that there's a strong candidate or two, and then we do the other search.
That's right.
So Todd brings up a good point, because from what you explained, Ron, I thought that we were going to go through the internal candidate and say yes or no definitely.
That may be the case.
That could be, but I think
I mean that's the process. Exactly. I mean, that's an option of the process.
Right. So the process is we could come up with a definite yes, we want this internal candidate, yeah. or a definite no, we don't want the internal candidate, or we want to look elsewhere, but we liked our internal
right.
candidate.
Yeah. Let's open up the process.
Lots of options.
Yeah.
Well, it just seems
and I think
a little
the timing,
unfair to the internal candidate if you say, well, we like you, but we're going to check everybody else out now, too.
I feel like looking at what the Vermont superintendent has given me in terms of the process and what neighboring districts have done, most recently Wyndham Central, I think it's a good process. And it allows us to see if there is consensus, and if not, there's a time frame to do something else. So I think it's following other districts that have done it very successfully.
Further questions? Moving on to new business, there's an action needed on revenue tax anticipation note. Do you have that?
Yeah, and I actually don't have it. Frank's coming a little bit later, so he will bring that document to come back to.
So anything else anyone else has under new business, or we would jump ahead to evaluation and goal setting? Okay, so going on to evaluation and goal setting. Perhaps we'll make up time since we're having VSBA goal setting information review. This is something I believe that Dave, you sent around to everyone?
Yeah.
I have sent that to everyone already. Any comments that you want to make about it, Dave? Any comments you wanted to make about them?
Just that it lays out some of the things we should be thinking about, and they show up in the planning part with the specifics. So it's just talking about the specifics and sort of focus on what do you want to talk about, how are you going to measure things. You know, it's all in that document. And that's, I think, what the agenda does here. So it's, I think we're doing it.
All right. And I think it's always good for us to review our roles, which is part of that documentation actually as well, but just that the role of the school board member is to set objectives, and we set the goals that we want to meet and how we're going to measure these objectives, and then we leave it to the administrators to put those into place. I guess the role of the administrators also is to help set the objectives so that they're not the goals, so they're not
overreaching
and high in the sky ideals. So then that leads us to establishing any specific goals that we have for ourselves as the school board. So I'll open it up to you guys.
Well, you should note that you accomplished one of your goals in terms of universal lunch and breakfast, so that's a nice thing that we've been able to start with this year after about 2 years of planning.
And it's a high-quality nutritional breakfast and lunch?
Well, I think we're...
close anyway?
Well, it's an ever... it's an ongoing issue. It's an ongoing process. It's very complicated. We could create a very nutritious, healthy menu for kids, but unfortunately the U.S. government's requirements don't support that. So we're working against the U.S. government requirements. For example, they don't require protein. At breakfast, it's all carbs, carbs and fat, and that's considered to be exceedingly unhealthy.
Well, there's the other side too, that the more nutritional, perhaps it's not what the kids want, and it's not as exciting.
To be honest, you know, what the kids will eat. Has been left, typically less of a problem than cost and federal requirements. The kids are, with minimal promotion, the kids are very flexible. I'm not saying every student's going to eat broccoli and Brussels sprouts, but we've had tremendous success with the Vegetable of the Month program, farm to school programs. You know, we have kids eating. Kids are very flexible when there's minimal promotion, and that's not just here. That's demonstrated throughout the nation. So I don't see that as real drawback. We eliminated chocolate milk a couple of years ago. I don't think we heard more than a murmur. An issue with chocolate milk is it has more sugar in it. Well, the same amount of sugar in basically 8 ounce chocolate milk has about what a 12 ounce can of Coca-Cola has in it. It's a branch of sugar. So we eliminated that. And we didn't have students complaints of issues with it.
So perhaps this isn't a goal, but it's a question. We've seen at Putney the results of getting rid of the cartons. Is that anything we could talk about doing with our Brattleboro schools and go to cups instead? I suppose there's a major problem in that you guys don't have kitchens and resources to clean them.
So I have had conversations with Cafe Services about the pros and cons of that. And in our schools, we have logistics. We don't eat in the cafeteria. We eat in 21 classrooms. So the just physical logistics of getting 21 large containers of milk into those classrooms is a chore. And I mean, someone has to do it. So someone either has to be paid to do it, or someone has to be taken away from the duty of teaching or supervising to do it. And then there's the act of pouring it for 17 kids per classroom and so forth. And then, of course, you need to put that in something, like a cup that now has to be either composted or recycled. So,
or washed.
Well, washed is means a dishwasher, which means now another process. And then you have to collect those, get them to the kitchen. Someone's got to wash them, and then get them back to the classroom. So those little processes do amount to, you know, to an effort that you have to make. And then there's also, I was told there's a sanitation issue. There has to be some standards in terms of if the milk's in a container and so on and so forth. So I reviewed that with Cafe Services and found like that it wasn't, that the gains, the potential gains, identified gains, weren't worth the amount of effort to accomplish that.
Julie, I think the thing that's compelling to me about what Putney did wasn't so much the 50,000 containers that aren't being thrown away anymore. It was that they're trying to move to transition to the students sitting down together and having a family style meal and having it being part of their literacy program, really, in terms of conversation and talking about things. And I think if we want to look into that, we should probably either go to Putney, which we talked about before, or have them kind of talk about how they do it and see how they deal with that. Because I think it's a very similar situation there, too. I don't know if they use a cafeteria or not, but obviously having 200 kids walking around with open containers of milk would present some problems. But I think it's worth looking into. I don't know that we want to do that now.
Well, it could be one of the goals would be to look into something.
Yeah.
And I think you're on that with the larger goal being not just milk or whatever, but just the... I was impressed, too, with what Putney has done with the local foods and the environment. And I don't mean to say that what we've done is anything to be looked at badly, because pulling up the nutritional standards and getting to... a non-paid breakfast for all students, is that the way to put it? That's a big, huge thing. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I don't want to take away accolades, but I guess I'd like to put it down as a goal to investigate and hear from Putney and see if there's anything that worked. I mean, obviously, Annie, what you say makes me go, the red milk. I mean, for me, the reason I bring up the milk is because it tastes better when it's not in a stupid cardboard container.
And it's fresh and local, like a lot of the other things that we try to get into the meals.
Well, I wasn't aware in my conversations that it would actually change the source. It would just change the way it's contained.
Well, I think Dave was just extrapolating from Putney's idea of being fresh.
No, they
and
get
local
it from they get it through. I'm not going to remember, maybe Taylor. I can't remember the name of the dairy. It's a local dairy that brings in the big machine with the big tank in it, and then it just poured into cups and kids walk through it. So it is a different source.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
It could be a pretty short investigation, because if they have a cafeteria, that changes everything. Like this idea of adding staff to your payroll, which we constantly talk about not doing, or taking someone away from the supervision and interaction with kids, which you don't want to do to execute these logistics, seems like a mess. So.
Yeah, I think there are a lot
could
of
start a phone call and maybe go to an investigation after, but it'd be interesting to find out how they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, our challenge at Academy, and each of the three Brat schools has unique challenges, but I can talk about ours in that we don't have a cafeteria And they're very, the kitchen is where the kids get their food, and it's a very narrow, constricted space. So the kids actually, we have to make like a horseshoe. The kids actually come in the same door the kids are exiting. So they come in, and they walk parallel to the serving area, and they turn around, and they come back out. And we've done everything there, including a couple years ago, creating new hot and cold containers and so forth for kids to expedite, because to get 375 lunches in a short amount of time means that everything's go, 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 go. And we're constantly looking at ways to get that faster. We constantly get complaints from kids and parents and teachers that the kids spend too much time on the line, not enough time eating, and then going out to recess. So it's that's a tension that we constantly try to address. We give about 55 minutes for lunch recess, and to get that many kids through for us in that space is quite a challenge.
I think we can put it on in the goals, and it may not go any further, but we could list that.
Right. So the only way that would work for us, we could not have the kids coming filling up their own milk in that space.
Right.
That's not physically possible. So it would have to be transporting the milk in some vessel to the 21 classrooms, where they would then pour into cups. That's the only way we could do it. And that's not, that's less, I think, attractive than what
Right, but I think David's is not just the milk. I think it's still a reasonable goal to look at Putney's and see if there's anything that we can glean from their experience that makes sense for us. We started with this because you mentioned what we've had success with, but any other goals,
Well, I think we should continue with the preschool, because I don't think that was a goal last year.
Right.
But I think we should put it listed as a goal and continue to investigate getting the preschools into the schools,
yeah,
public schools.
A second.
They were just looking at me like you had a second.
Sounds like you spoke before I did.
I didn't quite hear what that was.
Preschool. Continue investigating viability of preschools in the schools.
Viability of preschools, what?
In the schools.
In the schools, gotcha.
David, you always have goals down there.
What's that?
You always have goals.
Well, I don't know. I'm not sure if we're on the fourth part of the evaluation goal setting, or if we've gone into the planning part. So
no, not yet. We're on establishing goals.
Well, mine are mostly in the planning part.
All right. Mark, anything else for you on goals?
No, thank you for asking.
What about administrators? What's on your thoughts?
Boiler for Green Street.
Yeah. It's
that's something that we heard about there in June. I think that could be a goal to resolve that and figure out. It was both the two schools, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Reverting schools.
Green Street's on our priority list and needs to be our
I'm sorry, Jerry?
I believe Green Street was on a higher priority list than Oak Grove.
But it's on the list.
But it's on, but we're on the list.
Yep.
So that would, Jane, you have that one too as a goal? Mm-hmm.
More boilers for Green Street and Oak Grove.
I guess I'd make it a little bit wider because it was a whole energy efficiency, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's new boilers / energy efficiency recommendations, follow-up.
Yes.
Follow-up, right. Because I think we've already evaluated the feasibility of putting
right.
boilers in both of those.
Right, so it's moving that forward.
Just
move
that forward,
right.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Dust it
off.
Getting it what?
Getting it through town meeting.
Whatever process it's
going to
take.
Yeah.
Before you go.
Anything else, Mark, that you were thinking?
Just I think of my own school, but implementing new programs over the past 2 years at Green. We've implemented a new literacy program, Reading Street, and last year a new math program, Gage New York, which is now Eureka Math. And we have a new master schedule as well, and how we utilize our staff, moving as best we can to an MTSS model. those are major goals that I know all of us work on, but keeping that on the forefront is important.
Can you hear Jane over there?
Yeah, implementing new programs and new master schedule are major goals that often
I don't know if it's a goal, but I'd like to figure out how to interact with the kids more at this level, students in town. They came and did a presentation, I think, to the town reps, and I thought they did a really great job. But I don't know if there's a way to create some sort of access to the board directly from a student panel amongst three schools.
Yeah, we could do lunch. What I'd love to see is have the students from the three schools that were part of the leadership program this summer talk about their action plans and review those plans and then talk about what they're working on. So maybe once the school year gets set up, we could schedule their counselors and the adult supporters that work with them and have them come and do a presentation. I'll tell you, I didn't report this, but we had 80 some odd students at Landmark for 2 days, end of July, first day of August, and they were awesome. It was great. The workshops that they participated in were a little bit different and unique, and I've heard great feedback from the students. The adult supporters have already given us feedback in terms of a written evaluation that's very positive. But the follow-up work would be really great to see. So,
yeah, I think that'd be great.
Maybe that's something we can put together.
I just think there's something that'll help get us out of our charts and sheets and budgets when we hear from kids and we understand, like, it was so impressive to see them help each other and present. And I don't know if they were nerve-wracked or not, but they certainly delivered information. And it was just, it brings it home for me, you know, understanding all the things that we talk about here actually have a realness to it, and it's the students. And it's neat to get in touch with their leadership and learn from them as well.
I think it's a great experience for the students as well.
Yeah.
They're super proud of themselves after those presentations, that's for sure.
Right.
And their families are often.
Anything specific from you, Jay? Andy?
I think a goal should be, and I'm not clear on how to phrase this, so I'll express it and allow you to phrase it in a way that makes sense. Schools are changing because our kids, our communities are changing. And we're behind in that regard. We need to really focus on how we're going to continue to support kids and families. There are a number of homeless kids that we deal with every year now. That's not something that even 10 years ago was, you know, when I started Academy 11 years ago, we had a homeless family, that was a big deal. I was like, oh my God, can you believe we got a homeless family in Brattleboro? That was stop the press, that's big news. Now, that's an everyday occurrence. We're constantly trying to figure out how to get clothing for kids, shoes, sneakers, food in the evening. And then there's the substance abuse issue. We have scores of children coming to all of our schools every single day who are living in homes that a parent is addicted to a substance and doesn't have the ability to even remotely care for that child. And many of our kids are getting pulled out of homes or being investigated by DCF, put in foster homes during the school year. They're coming to school for 6.5 hours a day. It's the only stability in their life. And it goes beyond the classroom teacher. It goes beyond principals and counselors and so forth. We need more support. It's a community problem, but it's happening in our schools because the rest of the community is not stepping up. It's for kids. It's in our lap. We need to figure out how we're going to support these kids and families. You know, we, through a grant, hired a social worker. You know, those kind of things, I think, are going to be more and more critical in the future if we're going to really address the needs of these kids. And a lot of these kids, make no mistake about, we're saving them. That without the efforts of teachers and counselors and therapists in our schools, these kids just would not be making it. I read recent dropouts dropouts live, when I say it's a student that drops out of school will live, girls 10 years less than non-dropouts. Boys 13 years less than non-dropouts. And the kids we're talking about are, sorry to say, but you know, they're already, you can identify them as potential dropouts right now. These are the kids that are going to be dropping out of school because they don't have the supports necessary to get through school. And we have to figure out how we're going to make that happen.
I think it's pretty important to recognize that, that the schools can't do all of that. But the community is full, this community in particular, is full of organizations and private, public, nonprofit, and governmental that deal with all of this. There's a countywide hunger council that has programs in every single town to try and deal with that. There's a 16-page booklet that I think it's called the Lighthouse Program in Bellows Falls, the central, right next to Central Elementary. 16 pages of organizations that families can use in that area to get those kinds of supports. I think what's missing is the coordination and the communication to draw those things together. It's, you know, we have, or you all have your jobs to do. And those other things, there are other people doing those things, but who's putting it together? Who's overseeing it? Who's trying to bring community support into it? Because those organizations are there, those programs are there. There are dozens, hundreds of people in this area that are working on those kinds of things.
And I think that's good.
I mean, that's our difficult task, obviously. But
and it's been a goal before, too, but not effectively stated, I guess, as a specific thing. You know, trying to come up with and all you say, Andy, exactly like you said, how do you make that into a goal? Because that's the realities. And so is there any one or two things that we could look at and work towards that would start?
Well, even if you're, I mean, first of all, the great thing about this district is we talk about healthy lunches, we talk about after-school programs, theater, all these things, and those do provide opportunities outside of the school day to integrate kids in, but it's not enough. But even with professional development around trauma-informed education and looking at how these situations impact kids and having some of those professional development trainings for our staff, even just having them look at it through a different lens might spark them to say the right thing at the right time or provide the right call or the right service. So I think there probably are things that you can do during the school day that address these current situations that are different than going to a shelter or some of these other community resources that Dave mentioned. It might be worth looking into those things.
Can I jump in right now? I think Andy is, he's touched upon something that's probably been needed for quite a long time. He's absolutely correct. The schools, the teachers, the administrators, and all the districts are the ones who probably know who is at risk, what the problems are, and how best they can be solved. But they're teachers and administrators and other people within the district. Why not simply bite the bullet and start hiring some people as coordinators? Because the offshoot of something like this, the tension, the stress saved on the teachers and the administrators would be, the cost of that would be greatly alleviated by simply hiring a person who knows exactly who to contact of the 16 pages of resources in the Bellows Falls area. I think Brattleboro, if you had it all together, would be like 25 pages of resources. You've got the state, the federal, the local, the county, you've got a myriad, but everybody has one minute piece of the problem. There's probably so much redundancy in those 16 pages or the 20 pages that you could pay for these coordinators in each of the schools or districts many times over. And maybe that's what we need to do, is to actually hire somebody, and that is your job. You will look at those children who are in danger. You will look at those children that need the external supports that are offered out there, and you will coordinate that. If it's a teacher, so much the better, because at least they will come with a history of dealing with these kids. And like Andy said, that we have students that are living in the backseat of cars. Nowadays, that's a given. We have a line on our reports, you know, homeless kids. You didn't have this 10 years ago, and it was like Andy said, it was, my God, stop the presses. So instead of kicking this can around the block, maybe that's what we need to do, is take the lead, hire those people, and say, okay, we're going to run this. If you don't like it, then you can bow out, but we're going to run this.
So how about for
how about for what?
how about for today, this is just the idea of setting a goal for the year. This is the type of discussion that I think needs to have a lot of...
A lot of what?
We need to have some sort of an action is what I would like by the end of the year, some sort of a goal. And maybe we come up with it, you know, we set it as a goal for the year. Maybe we come up with an action here in the next month.
Maybe we come up with a job description of this person, and then we can see about budgeting and hiring at least one individual to do that.
So you want to do a specific goal of looking at that type of a position?
Absolutely.
I mean, I just have to say, you know, we're one of the districts that have HCRS clinicians.
Right.
We do have a social worker in our academy through one of the state grants.
Mm-hmm.
So we're actually kind of doing that. I think some of the frustrations are the outside agencies don't have the capacity to do much more than they're able to do.
Sure.
So it's not so much coordination, it's a question of capacity. So
well, maybe we're looking at too formal the organization. There's a ton of volunteer organizations, nonprofits, NGOs out there that could be doing it. Maybe we should apply for Red Cross Aid. Who knows? Because of the situations that many of the students find themselves in. I'm sure we would qualify. All we have to do is pony up and ask.
How long have we had the clinicians in? Not very long, right?
Oh, yeah. Today's Wednesday. Over 10 years.
Yeah. 10 years?
I don't
disagree
with you. What
are the positions that we hire?
I'm just saying that maybe you need to move this forward a little notch. Take the lead.
The clinicians...
That's what somebody else.
It's a cost share.
But they only started last year?
We pay their salary.
That's all our cost share?
Yeah. Okay. It used to be.
Oh.
Over the last 3 years, we've taken on that cost.
But our social worker was through a Title I grant.
And that's just new, right? Mm-hmm. That's what it is.
Last
yeah.
year started mid-year. And then all this year, it's grant funded. In all likelihood, it won't be grant funded next year. It's unlikely we're going to get her full salary. So probably in the budget process, I'm going to be asking that a portion, whatever doesn't get picked up, gets funded through our budget.
Well, I want a goal is all I'm looking for right now. I mean, I'd love to have a solution, but I think that's the solution that the whole country's been looking for.
The best thing
years.
We might come up with is a question that we can answer and explore, and I think Mark really kind of touched on is how do you coordinate, how can we contribute to coordinating support for students that we know need them? We know that the supports are around, we know that the agencies are overwhelmed, we know that there are lots of different service providers. How, and we know who the, or you in your day-to-day work know who the students are, how do we get that information out and get those services coordinated?
Right,
you know,
so
what can we do to improve that?
It should be a simple thing. I don't know if it was Mark or it was Andy that brought up the point, you know, nowadays there are certain kids who are in difficult economic situations and you're scrambling around for shoes, for clothing, for winter coats, for winter hats. How many volunteer agencies out there are collecting shoes, clothing, winter coats, and hats? You know,
there are 40 organizations in Wyndham County that are working on hunger.
All it requires is somebody who says, yeah, this is on page 2 of my own private book, and this is where you're going to go. Or I will go there and I'll get this for you.
Okay,
but we can't give you a ride.
But we can't give you a ride.
Yeah.
I'm trying to move us because we could spend a lot of time on this, I think. So, Jane, I think Dave kind of had a goal there. Can you say it one more time?
How do we coordinate support for students who need it?
There, that's simple enough, right?
We find a coordinator.
Well, I think the question is how do we do it, and then because Ron's thinking we may already have it, but that's our goal is to investigate that and to look into that more.
What a great job for formally.
Is that okay?
Sounds great.
I had two more thoughts here. I'd like to look at it as a goal for EES turnover to come down. I think we've heard about that for a while. I think we have some things Andy's mentioned,
staff turnover.
So maybe that'll address it, but I'd like that to be on our radar. And then a personal thing I keep pushing for, maybe it's silly to the rest of you so you can tell me if it's not a good goal, but I'd like to see our after-school programming work with the rec department directly in the town, somehow. And there's dead silence. Does that mean you all agree?
No, I think
what is that?
Yeah, what exactly are you?
Well, we already have them using a lot of our spaces, right, for after, but it usually doesn't happen right after school. The kids go from school, and then they have to go home, and then they have to come back to the rec department activity. And it may be that they were at Green Street for school all day, they did a after-school program, and then they have 10 minutes, or 2 hours, or 1 hour, or 20 minutes, I don't know. I'd just like to see a little bit better coordination on that, and discussion with the town, and see if there's any way that we could work together. Maybe some of the after-school opportunities and programs that we're offering could be some of these programs that are actually run by the rec department, and it'd be part of what we're putting out to students. I think from a parent's perspective, we look at it as, I need to have this time filled if I'm working, and I can't be there to pick up my kid. And so we look at the school for what's offered, we look around for what else is offered, we look to the rec department. And then in a lot of these cases, there's these dead zones, and you've got a half an hour, 45 minutes that you, what do you do with the kid, and then the kid doesn't get into the rec program? Maybe we can help them. Anyway, just investigate some coordination, see if that can happen. Maybe it can't. Maybe it's impossible. Are you all in agreement with that idea? Or
sure.
Do we have any other goals?
It's a pretty exhaustive list.
It is. And actually, we're only half an hour off time now. So we're on to planning, then, discussing topics. Welcome, Deb.
Thank you.
Discussing topics for the year. Dave, you said you had something underneath this.
Yeah, well, the agenda that you sent around, I'm not sure when, but a couple of weeks ago, and this fits into the VSBA, what was in the VSBA thing, and pretty much the first thing on the list is how do we monitor learning outcomes? I mean, that really is the job.
How do we monitor what?
Learning outcomes. And how do we know we're successful? What ways is that measured, and what ways can it be reported to us and to the public to show that the outcome, we're getting the outcomes that the students are getting, the outcomes that we're trying for?
So,
and I know the NECAP and SBAC are the ones that we hear the most about, but they don't really measure student performance. And we did get those, Bryn Tucker put together those, and Lyle put together those Ames Webb graphs. But we have them and had a look at them. We haven't really talked about what the indicator. And I don't know what other, we have a lot of assessments. I've heard several times we use a lot of assessments, but we don't see the results or the data. So I guess the question is, how do we want to monitor the learning outcome? How do we want to know what's happening, what the results are?
I would just suggest that I think that SBAC does monitor student performance.
Secretary of Education doesn't agree with you.
Well, that's her right to not agree with me, how dare she, but no, I think it does measure performance because it's based on the Common Core. I don't want to get into a big discussion about it, I just felt compelled that when that statement's made to at least offer another viewpoint or perspective.
We also talk about student presentations at board meetings. That's another layer of way to see how students are developing, and not just a piece of paper, but we have all these programs going on in the school. There are other ways to highlight them than us doing a principal's report, but actually bringing kids in front to share what they're doing.
We didn't talk about teachers doing presentations, but we did have, I don't remember if it was last year, some teachers here at Oak Grove talking about Reading Street and implementing that. That would be a good time for some teachers to showcase, here's how I assess and here's how I know that my students are progressing. And with the new math program, I think that would be a perfect thing for us to be doing.
Yeah, well, for both, actually those were two other things on the specifics list, the new reading and math programs. So.
Does that address what you're asking?
Part of it, but I just...
So the assessment, we can give you like Ames Web data, and we have wish swimming in Angel Data constantly because of how we use it. All, you know, we, with Angel, we benchmark all of our students 3 times a year, September, January, and May. From that data, then we look at individuals who aren't making the benchmark, which is a national benchmark, and we tell these 10 kids in third grade need to be progress monitored, which means we keep a close eye on them and there's some level of intervention. There's a discussion with the classroom teacher or title teacher or special educator, what should that intervention be? What does this child need to help accelerate their learning to get to that benchmark? And then there's more frequent assessment. These are very quick assessments that usually take a minute or in literacy, a minute or two, or up to 8 minutes in math. So they're very quick, and they're used as screeners. And so, but the data is important for instruction. You know what I mean? So it gives teachers more information to figure out how I can improve the student's progress.
But after that's happened, how do you determine whether, you can look and see if they reached the benchmark. Do you track how many of them did and how many are being successful?
Yes.
I mean, that would be one way.
So we do have school-wide data. We do grade level data, school-wide data. After the benchmark period, we look at that data at the school. And I think at this point, Paul Smith, which Brian Bittner will come to each school, and schools will review that data with all the teachers in small groups, and figure out there are things we can do based on that data to improve instruction, to improve student outcome, to improve that growth.
Right.
And what we found that the Ames Web data is very closely highly correlates to SBAC. So we know that students who are on benchmark will do well on SBAC. And students, and Brian can talk to you in terms of literacy about the exact percentages and the correlation. I can't do it off the top of my head.
I think the key is the multiple methods of assessment. We don't just use the SBAC. The SBAC is a very valuable tool, but it's the Ames Web, it's the local classroom assessments. It's things like climate surveys that we use. We use the parent surveys. You know, this is information that we give you on a regular basis. I think we just need to make sure that we continue doing that.
I think the secretary's issue with SBAC is it shouldn't be used as a sole indicator of student success, and I would agree with that. But it does measure student performance. But we should not look at that and just say, well, the student, is a 2 or a 3. And use that as a sole determining factor, or as a graduation requirement, or as a promotion requirement.
I would take it one step further when principals and Brian and Paul have been meeting in these data meetings. We look at a group of students that are missing a certain skill, or we need something to accelerate their learning, and then we base our professional development on what those needs show us, so that we're really helping teachers know this group of students needs this, and here's how we're going to help you so that you can accelerate their learning.
Right.
And accelerate is key to what Andy was talking about, because the students that aren't making benchmark need to move faster because they're behind. Mm-hmm. They need to be able to catch up, and they need to accelerate.
Yeah, so, and what I'm asking is for us to see how that's working. You know, we understand, I think we've heard this and pretty well understand that's the process. And what I'm asking for is something to show that it works. And I think the parent survey actually want to talk about later on, and which I haven't really looked at the climate survey carefully, but that as well, we probably should talk about as well in terms of their actual validity. But right now I'd like to stay with the student performance stuff and see if we could see, you know, when you see the kids that need to be accelerated and then you benchmark them again, what happened? And let us see that, or let us hear about that. We'll see.
So. I'm not trying to be argumentative with you, but
I know.
But we gave it to you,
yeah.
And I think we run the risk of maybe perhaps giving too much data and not explaining it well. But we gave it to you at Academy School
at
a meeting at a forum,
yeah.
And it looked like that. And Paul, I think Paul's going to present it. We gave that to you
Well, there are not exactly like that, but there are a series of bar graphs.
This is the graph that was used that night, one of them, there's a bunch of them. You, by then, you're probably swimming and wondering what we were talking about.
That was during the town meeting presentation, right?
Yes, it was.
And I think what David's getting at is that the town meeting rep presentation sometimes includes information that I sit there and say, huh. And I don't really want to sit and say, huh, at that point.
Yeah, it's to see it, but also have it explained, and that, you know.
That type of information I'd rather see for the board and have it presented to us, Lyle, when you guys are, instead of just in front of all the town reps, but to have it for the board and have us have some time to actually ask some of those questions that David asked.
I feel like that's happened. Am I not?
I think we see some of it, but I remember some of that particular one, I think it was only given to us that.
So I think you're right.
Just as a reminder, I know Paul last fall was in this room.
Was in this room.
Going through all that data.
All of them.
So we'll continue to do that. That's the stuff that we're talking about.
There was something definitely different in March than what Paul presented to us in the fall.
No, I know. That's kind of the culmination. But so maybe a month before town meeting, you get an update. Something like that.
It seems as simple as taking an inventory of how you guys feel like you're assessing students' progress and us agreeing like, oh yeah, that looks good, and then putting it on a schedule like twice a year or whatever, we get updates. I mean, I feel like we get that information constantly, but maybe I'm wrong, but I don't know. I'd like to just go see a play or if I want to know how kids are learning in a variety of ways, it's those other programs that I'm more interested in. That's just my bias, but the reason I can feel that way is I feel like every time we question or have Brian come in or someone come in, or Brynn we had present, I mean, we've had several different presentations. I personally feel like we're getting the information, but maybe if we had an inventory and we knew what those things were and were on a schedule, we wouldn't have to sit here and try to recreate from our memories, but.
It's also really valuable to do it, to give the public access to that in these meetings so that they know that we're being successful. Those conversations don't have to happen because there's constantly evidence being presented that we're not.
Okay, so there's one topic definitely on the list. David, you have a whole list of people.
Well, yeah, how do we know, or how will we know that MTSS is a successful program? The whole state is being asked to adopt that model. So how do you measure it? I mean, how are you knowing that this is working? And what can you show us to share that?
So
and I think the same
MTSS
with, well, I mentioned the new programs as well.
So yeah, we've talked about what MTSS is, but he wants some specifics of how do we measure that and how do we know. That would be another topic.
And the PBIS as well, that we've been doing for a number of years, is, you know, what's the effect been on behavior? What do you, you know, in terms of, what do the numbers show us? Are these valid programs, or is something going to come along in a few years and replace them, which, you know, we see over and over again in public education?
Well, the answer is always yes.
Always yes?
Yes, something's got to come along and replace, yeah. You know, that's
something.
So always be something that'll, you know, won't be PBIS forever.
Right.
No more than there was NECAP forever. And it'll be SBAC for a while, it'll be something else. And it'll be Common Core, and it'll be something else. So education's evolving. And it's the speed at which it changes is accelerating. So we'll continue to see that.
Right. But our responsibility, again, is to monitor the outcomes. And if there must be a way that you know, other than that, gee, that people really like it or really proud of their work, there must be a way that you know that this is a successful program or you wouldn't keep doing it. And so I just think share that with us. Show us that evidence.
Things I think about in terms of behaviors in PBIS, we could look at the number of out-of-district placements that were reduced. We can look at
student climate data,
behavioral data.
The behavioral data, yeah, is kind of what I'm, yeah, I don't think we've seen that. Yeah, I would call some of that.
I mean, you could do just basic one, how many less trips to the principal's office?
That's what I mean about that.
Yeah.
Right.
Which I think Mark has talked about before.
Yes. Yeah.
And perhaps, too, another way to show that to us, it's not as statistically relevant, perhaps, but it's an anecdotal, actual case. Have let a teacher or somebody that feels really strongly about it, explain to us. Sometimes for me, the best things that you guys do is when I can relate more directly to it. So I think of like a bus story where somebody explains exactly how that happened.
I think too, a really specific thing that I'd love to, for us to be able to really publicize is your student senate, the restorative justice process, and just how is that, showing that this is a really good thing, everybody should be doing this, and just kind of blowing our horn on that one, and showing that this is, the things we're doing are really making a difference. Because obviously behavior is a big issue, right?
What was your other topic? You had something about the student surveys?
Well, the tech plan, the current tech plan is, I think this is the last year, or maybe last year was the last year of it. And when we saw I think it was the Title I request, Jill, you mentioned, there were a bunch of different things that were going on with technology when you were, our people week. Talking and how is this being coordinated? You had some questions about that. Do you remember what
was it on the 1% request?
I think it was when we were talking about the 1%. But just in general, we've made a needed and significant investment in technology. I'm sure we're going to continue. And but that we should. I know you have to send data to the state every year. But is there a plan for how things would be? There were a number of people that developed some. The website redesign this. But there were other things where people were developing tools. For use with students, and the questions, are they going to be shared around?
Are
we maximizing the use of the technology and the collaboration opportunities with the staff?
What I recall, and that was like the 1% with the smart boards and the iPad. And I think the question that we had is that when we get done, we pay for the 1% for somebody to develop something, how is that utilized and shared and sent around? So just I think the larger question of technology, professional development, and use, just a report on that at some point would be good.
We have a staff person for technology integration.
Yes, we hired last year. We through that Title I grant, Oak Grove had a gentleman that served as our technology integration specialist. He was here 15 hours. A week, mm-hmm. And now he's actually going to be part-time at Green Street, and again continue part-time at Oak Grove, or I say part-time loosely because I don't know exactly how many hours he's going to be there, but our staff was, they're thrilled to have him, and we're thrilled to have him back. He's really, rather than having like the Eno boards and some art boards are in the room, having them being used to just project things on, I mean, really how to make them interactive, right, and useful. The one-to-one Chromebooks that we have all the way down to grade 2 to grade 6 now, and making it a tool, manageable, a balanced, but yet, manageable tool for teachers. And he's in the classrooms and helping. He even helped a lot with SVAC and helping looking at some of that data. But even and then going beyond and helping to some of the staff drill down into looking at that data and what does the data actually tell us, kind of like what Andy was talking about.
And I'm not sure that needs to be kind of scheduled or itemized or really clearly described, but that's not my field, so I wouldn't know about that. But typically, there is a plan for how that's carried out.
Any other topics for anybody for the year?
Anybody else? I do have a couple more. And I sent all these around, so I don't.
And you've been taking notes all year, so that's fine.
Yeah. The others, the parent survey, which it's invalid. I mean, I don't know how else to describe it. It's the percentage of people that fill it out, even with somebody in the lobby asking people to fill it out, mm-hmm. is way too small to actually reflect what parents think, and the number of questions is way too large for you to be able to get get an adequate response or an adequate number of responses.
Where does that thing come from?
I can't remember our numbers from last year, but we had a tremendous.
I think it was around 40%.
I thought it was closer to 60, but I don't remember off the top of my head.
Yours was high, I think, from comparison.
We're down in the 20%.
And I don't think this year, I don't know if we got the results of the surveys from Oak Grove and Academy, but I mean, the point is that it's not a valid instrument. And I would encourage you to talk to Paul and see about how to design something that really would give you valid information, because it's not useful. It's not usable. It tells you what those people thought on that particular day about all of those different questions, but it's not a valid survey. It's not a valid instrument for measuring parents' feelings or parents' feedback.
I disagree.
It's more a statistics question.
Go for it, Pat.
Well, I mean, a lot of stuff is getting said as if it's representing the whole board's view, and I just want to say that, I mean, are all polls invalid? You certainly don't get more than 30% of a national participation in polls. I mean, there's statistics to back up what percentage you need to represent a whole body of opinion. I think that having these climate surveys amongst kids, we saw the data from the kids and data from the parents, I think it is helpful. I think you could always improve, but I think saying something is invalid takes its meaning and weight away. And I'd like to say that I like seeing those things, and I have often thought, oh, how could we get deeper? How could we get more? But I don't think they're invalid. I think they show us what people are thinking. And I've done surveys at other schools. I'm in charge of another school, and we get surveys sometimes, and the input we get back isn't as strong as what we get here in Brattleboro. So I would like to look towards improving those things, but I would certainly want to go on record as saying I don't think they're invalid.
I think the climate survey, every student does that.
So it's 2 through 6.
Yeah, so it's clear, it is valid, because you've got all the information and there it is. But with the parent survey, it's not random, and it's also not targeted the way a nationwide survey, which actually might only be 5 or 6% of the people who are polled, that they choose them specifically to represent a particular perspective. But again, rather than talk about it this way, I just want to ask Paul what he thinks. I mean, he's an expert. I understand he's an expert in that area, and see what he would suggest for a really good parent survey.
I know Brent did the analysis of Green Streets last year, and was our data coach for the supervisory unit for a few years. And she indicated to me that our response, given the percentage that took the survey, is very valid.
Mm-hmm.
Statistics.
Yeah.
So we were proud of our results.
Yeah, oh, the results are great.
Well, so I'll talk to Paul and Bryn and come up with some standards that are that would actually maintain the validity of our current surveys.
Right. Yeah. Well, the other things were, I don't know when our audit contract is up, but the town bid out the auditing contract and had several people respond and wound up with really significant savings, because the books are so in such good order that the amount of time it was going to take was really not not as extensive as the previous auditors were saying. So I just wanted to suggest that whenever that's up, that we put that out to bid and see if we can save some money in the audits. And the other is to look meet with the Richards Group and talk about alternative sources for our healthcare. Bisbit is has been the provider for schools and school insurance for years and years and years, and their rates are no longer really significantly better than anywhere else. And we might find that looking locally and going in with some other SUs, we could wind up with a better plan. And we know we're going to be looking at significant changes in the future, unless the feds put that off for a couple of years again. And knowing what's available and what, you know, what the private market will do rather than what Visit's doing, which is represents, I'll leave that alone, but I'm not sure that they're going to be able to continue to provide us with competitive healthcare or with healthcare coverage that we want. And there's going to be a lot of changes coming. And I think rather than wait for those changes or wait even for the next contract negotiation, that we start looking at what options are out there and what we might present in negotiations for saving.
So to me, that one should be passed on to Mark on the finance committee.
Well, I was looking at it right now, and our current contract is good until November 2017. So
it comes up in June, yeah. So we'll be negotiating this fall.
Yeah, we're going to negotiate this fall.
And the message from VSBA is, and from the Superintendent Association as well, is consistently get, start talking about these things now, way ahead of time. Don't wait until it's all backed up in front. And the town was able to, it's a different situation because the town employees do make co-pays and they have deductibles that are pretty significant, but the town was able to work with Richards to come up with a lower premium policy that had higher co-pays and higher deductibles. But by setting up a health savings account, they were able to keep the cost the same for the employees, but reduce the premium by tens of thousands of dollars. I think we're looking at 30, even if everyone uses every bit of their copay and deductible, we'll still see a $30,000 savings in the, across the employee base. So looking at some of those options rather than just taking the visit packages that come to us might be wise.
I thought one of the options that was being looked at was a self-insured pool. Is that from Visbit or just from somebody else? That's what we talked about last
time. You probably know more than us, Mark, because you're on that clinic. Okay, so I think that gives us a bunch of topics. Hopefully Jane has them all down. Yep. And then the next bullet on here is discuss needs and dates for any community forums. We've done community forums more intensively 2 years ago. Did we do anything last year at all? Do we need to do anything again?
I thought we already planned on the math.
Yeah, we should do the new math program.
I thought that was going to be a presentation, not necessarily a community forum.
But I'm not sure the difference.
The presentation is just somebody coming talking to our school board. The community forums, when we specifically are inviting and presenting to the community, like we did with the preschool, or we asked for input from the preschool folks. So we've done two on preschool this last year. Not sure if we did anything else really last year, except the budget presentation is always standard during town meeting, and then we did talk about Act 46 a little bit at the end of that.
You'll need to schedule a public hearing on Act 46.
Public community forum.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's already being scheduled by the Act 46 committee.
Well, it's got some tentative dates, but you're going to have to decide, you know. I mean, in conjunction with the study committee.
So we kind of need to wait for the Act 46 committee to decide for sure, and then come back to it.
Yeah. I'm just saying
that's
a topic.
He's just pointing out that there is one topic of a community forum on Act 46 that would be, after it's been sent up to the state, if that's what we vote to do tomorrow night, then the state would look at it, and then we would have community forums in each of the towns to talk about that. So that would be one community forum. But I think we've also talked about preschool, wanting to follow up. I think we even promised people, didn't we, October, November, that we were coming back to that in October, I believe you said, at the last preschool forum. I think you said October, what's in my head. Is there anything else that we all think we need to be presenting?
I mean, all these forums have to be decided now.
No, but I think it's good if we have kind of the idea of this meeting is to have like a layout of the year in general. If we had thoughts that we definitely wanted to include, stuff can come up and we can do.
I mean, if we're going to look further into Andy's question about given the current status of kids and families around having their needs met, it might be nice to hear from families.
Yeah. Or it might be nice to hear from other community providers and ideas.
Yeah.
Agencies.
Maybe we can throw a date just to write something down, January or something, to begin that.
The budget stuff.
March is when we present the budget stuff.
We're 6 weeks out.
No, we start talking about the budget already in November, December, but we would have to approve our budgets.
Was there a date selected for the math presentation?
The presentation to just the school board, or are we really talking about a community forum where we think parents and community members want to come in and hear about our math group?
Well, to my mind, when there's a difference between a presentation and a form. Presentation is, this is the math we're doing, or some new programs we're doing, and it's an explanation about it. A forum, to me, suggests, well, we're going to talk about all math programs and what the options are, and it's opening up to the community for input. We're not really, we're presenting, we're not asking for input on, we've already selected on math program.
Right, that's,
we want
so
to explain
I,
it.
I thought the presentation of the math was just part of our topics, and you guys were going to try to fit in when the topics worked. That,
we're not calling out a forum.
I wasn't.
Yeah, and that, my question was, do you have a date for that? Do you want to, so it sounds like you want us to give you a date for that.
Yes.
Okay. We can do that. We'll definitely want
to. I thought that made more sense that we come up with the topics and you all tell us what makes sense to when you want to tell us about it.
Just another concept about informing the board, inviting them to a math night, where you have parents and students coming and doing the math, getting exposed to the program. That would be much more interactive, and I don't know. You guys, schools do it on different nights, probably.
Is there a math
night? Is that ours isn't always focused on math.
Yeah.
Because I don't remember a math night specifically in each of the schools.
We did do a technology night last year, and we talked about technology quite a bit. I think those are great opportunities to see.
So the idea there, I think, is valid, and when you're looking at when to discuss topics, if there's something that happens during those things, instead of us, perhaps we change our meeting to match with that, and we participate in something that's like the parents would to hear that. But it'd be nice if we were able to schedule it so that it's not in addition to another.
Right. Yeah.
So that does bring us to the deciding dates for future meetings. And our, I think it's kind of a check-in, but we always need to check in on it. Our schedule has been the first and third Wednesdays at 5 o'clock. Last year, in anticipation of additional meetings for a study committee, Act 46 group, we decided that we would meet mostly monthly and sometimes twice monthly. What is the idea of the board this year? What would you feel like you want to do? And do administrators feel like we didn't have enough opportunities for you to give us feedback, or did we? When we went to a one-time meeting, was it too little or no? Deb's saying one time was good. Andy?
Well, it's, you know, there's pros and cons, I mean, the trade-offs. One night is great, that's one night a month, less than to a meeting for everybody. I think the challenge is to have the meeting stay within the time frame.
We did stay within the time frame quite well.
We tried, a few years ago, we tried that for several months, and we wound up with the meetings running much longer because there's much more business to transact. And a lot of what we, well, I think if you look at all the list of things that we just created in terms of goals and other stuff, I think we got quite a bit of work, and if we're going to kind of seriously take on the issue of how to support families and how to get more community support for kids and their families, I think that's going to require some time and some pretty serious effort, and maybe some forums as well. But
we just scheduled a forum while you're out of the room.
Great.
We just talked about putting that on the
maybe
list.
Maybe that's why I thought of it on my way back.
Did we do once a month until?
Well,
budget season.
I'm looking at last year's. We did two in September, one in October, one in November, December, but then we started to have our budget meetings outside of that, so we had a bunch of those meetings. And then two in January, one in February, one in March, two in March, one in April, one in May, two in June. So it's almost like every other month we were doing two meetings, and part of that was scheduling the forums. There was a forum in November, there was one in February, and another one in March.
So off the top of my head, I would say that we're talking about a community forum of preschool, November type time frame, January was the next forum, is that what you just said?
February.
Move to February. January or February, perhaps, on this, how to surround services and do all that needs to be done. And then again, March is the constant with the budget presentation to the town meeting. I felt like last year's schedule didn't short anybody, but worked.
Second.
Andy's nodding, Deb's nodding.
You know, I mean, it would be...
What?
Ron's looking at me like, shut up, Eric. I mean, I'm not looking for more meetings, but I'm just thinking that there's a lot of business that takes place, and, you know, to have like an the opposite be the presentations. But I heard from, you know, David and many of you that, yeah, you're looking for staff to come in and talk about what's going on in schools, MTSS student presentations, and I don't think those have to be, those are hard to cram into a business meeting, because I know we've had a student presentation last year, so the business takes place, and then you have people waiting and waiting and waiting and keeping people out late to just do that presentation. So to have...
So Jerry, maybe to do that...
To have like business, the beginning and then to have just an occasional every other month or whatever, where it's the presentation.
Or maybe what Todd is talking about too, and what you were just talking about, the information from the technology night or math night or art night, maybe that's an easier thing to do. If we schedule that as an actual board meeting and we attend that and we see those things.
That could be the school information night too.
That's another time to do that sort of
thing. If you look at the calendar, you would probably be able to see that almost every month or every other month with these community forums you've just added in, and then a couple other shorter presentations or coming into the schools, you could probably fill, you know, not every month, twice a month, but something similar to what Ron has. I just remember how long it was for the teachers doing the reading street, because there's so much other business stuff happening, and they're coming in, and all the times they stay after school because we start early at 5, but then they don't even have an opportunity to present until like 6, 6:30, and it makes for a long evening for them.
We typically will then first.
It didn't happen with reading street, and then even the drama, I think, was
there
the last year.
There was a reason for that.
There was someone else here presenting.
Then somebody with nutrition came in.
Yes.
And,
Yeah, otherwise it doesn't normally happen. We normally move people right to the very beginning. But I guess I would suggest at this point that we kick it back to Ron.
Yeah, let me put a draft schedule like we did last year, and then just remind me, I can get it from Jane, the topics, math, were there three?
The reading program, the new
for
reading
the community
program.
Forum?
Yeah.
Or the community forum, staff forum.
Forum. The topic list is more like 6 or 7 things.
Yeah, TSS, right. Behavior.
Yeah, I'm asking about the forums.
The forums, the preschool.
Preschool, how to support families.
Supporting families. Not math.
Budget.
Oh,
right.
Yeah,
it's more presentation.
Except for with MTSS, I wasn't clear. I don't know if, Dave, you were asking for a presentation on MTSS. You were asking for how do we know it's working.
Well, I think both, because this came from last year. We had an email from a parent who was asking about the math program, and we thought that the way to respond to that would be to have a public, you know, to present information about and have an opportunity for people to come in and ask questions if they had them. And it just seems like I'm not sure MTSS would fit in that. The more I was looking for data, you know, that's correct. But with the reading and math programs, public presentations and let people know if they wanted to come and had questions, that would be the opportunity.
I heard someone say something like a mini case study, where if you had a student who was not performing where we thought they should, and then describing that, what was done, the interventions the teachers used, and then showing the results of that. It seems like it could show you every step of the
Okay, so We have 1 hour. There's food that has arrived somewhere into this building. How?
It should be done instead of in the cab.
Okay. I don't know. I just told him to bring it here. I wasn't very specific.
Oh, you want it? Oh, yeah.
Here.
I think if we set it up so that it can be a 4 to 6 part of the meeting.
Okay.
Or is that correct?
Yeah.
Well, I only ordered sandwich type things for us now, and then a cookie platter for the people of the public as they came into the community forum. So I'm thinking it might be good if we grabbed those sandwiches and came back and did our Act 46 review here. Unless for sure we'll be done in a half an hour and we can get out there and take that food before people start showing up and make it confused. Should go grab it now, yeah? So can we take a quick recess, find the food that was delivered for us, and then come back and do a working session while we eat on reviewing Act 46? And Frank is going to walk over the part that we skipped because he needed to have action on it and he was going to explain it.
The 20 bites, right?
Well, okay, he doesn't get to eat yet.
So what we have is a tax anticipation note. I'll send this around. It requires board signatures. Does anyone recall doing one of these in the last 5 years?
No.
You do? Some do, Sabella?
Oh, sure.
Okay, it's not been usual and customary, so we'll start from you, Jill. For Brattleboro Town School District, because you've had sufficient cash flow to finance your July-August operations before tax receipts. But John O'Connor told me that this year tax bills were going out a little bit late. I think part of that had to do with some of the changes in school funding.
Yep.
He let me know early on that we would not have our usual advance right about now to cover that period where we're running, you know, the payrolls and the setup costs for opening school. So I do a cash flow analysis, and it identifies the difference between our spending and our revenues, essentially a cash flow deficit. I send that to the bank for review. They create a resolution and an agreement to lend money. This is short-term lending. The rate is 1.35%, and it is specifically a note in lieu of taxes. It's a tax anticipation note. As soon as the taxes are received, we will be back to our normal cash flow. But that's the purpose of it, and it's a resolution with People's United Bank. 1.9 million. And you know, we're a $15 million budget, so it's essentially a little less than 2 months operating cash.
It's not really good for legal documents.
any questions? It does require a majority of board signatures, and Kim, if you would sign under the clerk, and then I'll have John O'Connor sign as treasurer. And there are several documents.
No splash mustard on.
Okay, so that takes us to the next part. I'd like us to have enough time to read through this, but I also want us to be out there a little bit before 6 so that if anyone does come for this forum, they're not standing there wondering where we are.
And then, Jill, would you just do a motion to approve that resolution?
We need a motion as well. Sorry.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can we have a motion to approve that?
We do.
So moved.
Seconded.
Did you get that, Kim? Are you on her notes now? Dave and then Mark need a motion to approve this short-term lending. And then any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Alrighty. So the Articles of Agreement, this is our last chance as a board to look through this before they would go back for any concerns that we have to the study committee. Tomorrow night is scheduled for an actual vote on whether or not to send this up to the state. And I think I'd give it to Ron to walk us through any parts of that.
That's a good part.
Is it enough light for you?
Not really.
You want to set
them
with the lights on?
Yeah.
So just so you know,
let me
turn lights on.
And just to note that we want to do look at the Articles of Agreement, then we also have on here any financial implications, Brennan vote, and what this means to the town's process overview, timelines, any concerns or suggestions. So perhaps you don't want Ron to actually walk us through line by line in the Articles of Agreement, but up to you all on what you would like. Dave and Todd in particular, since the other three of us have been at the meetings where we go through this. I mean, we could start with the Vernon vote and talk there, since that's the most recent thing that's happened. Yes?
The only question I have is if you could explain how the board is going to, the election for the board, how that's going to work.
Yep.
If you look on page 7.
You mean the board makeup or the actual voting for the board?
The voting. There's something about everybody voting.
Yes.
At large.
It's at large voting. On page 7, Article 8. So it's
Joe.
So that paragraph, Unified School District Board representation, the Unified District Board directors will be comprised of 9 school directors, all of whom are elected at large by electorate of the Unified Union. 3 are from Brattleboro, so you need to be a eligible resident of Brattleboro. One would be from the each of the other communities, one from Dummerson, Guilford, Putney. And then 3 directors would be designated at large and eligible residents of any of the above referenced towns. You might remember probably a few months ago, we went away from the direct population where Brattleboro would have 5 representatives and the outlying towns would have 1 each, to have more of an opportunity for at-large in other districts. And that's where you have the chart there where it has Brattleboro 3, Dummerston, Guilford, Putney 1, 3 at-large for a number of 9. But in that process, you have to do an at-large vote. In other words, people from the whole supervisory union would be voting. 3 from Brattleboro would have to be residents. 1 from each, Dummerston, Putney, Guilford, would have to be residents of those towns. But the 3 at large could be residents anywhere.
So, including Brattleboro.
Including Brattleboro.
I guess my question is, in that case, if say Brattleboro, if Brattleboro voters, the majority of them, chose one a particular candidate, and then the other towns all chose the second one, or for the smaller towns where the where it matters more because they only have 1 rep, if the people in that town favored one candidate and the other towns voted for another one, then the town's majority of the town's votes would be overridden by the rest of them.
Yep. That was kind of the trade-off.
That was part of the trade-off of not doing a percentage, a population, direct representation of your population vote to make this board up?
The trade-off.
The 2 ways to do this that are legal are the normal, in my mind, the normal way you do it, your population makes up the representation of the board. Mm-hmm. And by that, that would mean that automatically Brattleboro would be the larger portion of the board. So the second option for us was this at-large voting. The other thing that's curious to think about, I mean, it's actually possible that if Dummerston had 3 people running in the at-large positions and their own representative, I mean, Dummerston could be, or Guilford or Putney or whoever else, could actually hold all of those positions. They would have to be voted on by everybody.
Yeah, that seems like a long shot, but the Waste Management District, which is countywide, Brattleboro has 1 representative, but they have 6 votes. And Westminster has 2-1 rep with 2 votes, and all the other towns have 1 rep, and that's obviously based on population. And I think that's been in place since the 60s, and it works it works pretty well. I'm surprised that the surrounding towns would support not getting the possibility of not getting the person that the majority of their voters preferred on the board. It just seems pretty convoluted.
I think when we thought about it, your way that you're describing seemed more convoluted because it wasn't a clear one full vote. You could have somebody with 0.6 votes or 1.2 or whatever. I remember discussing that briefly. Anybody else remember?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think that was different. I don't think that's what Dave is talking about.
No.
I think he's talking about Brattleboro voters voting on Dummerston Rex.
They could have. Exactly. And outvoting the Dummerston voters. Mm-hmm. So they wouldn't get the person that they actually supported in the majority.
Well, but we had legal counsel describe that because this was the best way for the smaller towns to get
more than one
possibility of a vote instead of having Brattleboro automatically taking it because of our size.
Do we know if the candidates are going to be listed with the town they reside in, listed next to them?
Oh yeah, they'll have a ballot with the town, and then another ballot would be at large.
So I'd like to hear financial implications in the Vernon vote part. If you guys don't have specific questions on the articles of agreement.
Jill, I have one question. Do we need to say somewhere in here that the WSED will be the grantee of the Head Start program and really win the grantee?
That's a good point. Because the grantee would no longer exist.
Right.
So it would be in the unified district that would be the grantee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good point. I think we have to put that in. Mm-hmm. There is some phrasing.
No, I think it actually is in there in terms of how the supervisor union district ends and then the new unified district comes in.
Okay.
I can't find it off the top of my head, but
I just happened to see Article 2, rates to operate, and that made me think about that. But if it's covered that way, it should suffice.
Yeah, I'll fund it.
So Frank, can we ask you to walk us through what it means financially to us if the vote is for Vernon to leave? Mm-hmm. And stand alone.
Sure. So there's a number of factors that affect the answer to that question. So Vernon pays approximately $150,000 into the supervisor union assessment for the administrative services. So that's really what I think what the implication you're raising, Jill, is. So what does the union look like with $150,000 less in cash flow to fund the SU office? So that's one question. The other is the Vernon budget's about $4.5 million. And you recall the analysis we did that had all of us together, the $57 million, mm-hmm, in the study committee. So if you take go from a $57 million unified system to a 53, you know, minus the $4 million. Under both scenarios, what we find is that the benefits of the union, as we've studied in the study committee work through student-teacher ratios and efficiencies in operations, which include central office functions, are going to net the negative impact of having one less member. The really significant analysis that gets to your question is when Vernon gets pulled out of the BUHS budget,
Now they don't pay tuition for their 100-and-something students that attend. However, there's no indication that the BUHS Vernon students are not going to continue to participate. That's really the core of, well, what are the implications? And the answer is, we've done the analysis, the answer is the tax rate and the tax rate calculation that's extended from the BUHS budget as it is now would be very similar if Vernon is cutting a check for those 100 students as a tuition-paying town, much like Marlboro does, you know, Dover does, and so on. It's new revenue if they cut a check, but we lose students. When you do the analysis, it turns out that there's really very little difference. And the key point there is the assumption that the Vernon students would continue to attend Brattleboro Union. So any school, as you know, will have a negative tax impact if we lose students and don't change costs. So the big picture is no significant effect. From a financial point of view, I think we see the unified system better off if we all stayed in the same system, because for all the reasons that we've talked about around the way in which the funding formula and educational opportunities improve when we have a stable unified system. But there are other small pieces that also would explain the lack of a negative impact. For example, Title I funding. The supervisory union will still get Title I funding in the amount of the Title I eligible students that that are identified through the census process. Well, Vernon's not a Title I school, and yet we try to share the consolidated federal program resources with Vernon. So if they're not part of our supervisory union, they wouldn't be eligible for that. We would retain those sorts of resources. This is probably $80,000 in our own SU. And that would be redistributed to fewer members. So that means more resources for the current members, the remaining members. And that's how we get to what's the offset when we lose the administrative revenue for central office services. Those sorts of things balance themselves out pretty readily.
So what about the fact that they also signed on and were responsible for the $55 million renovation project?
Yeah, very good question. So we're asking an attorney who's got experience dealing with school debt and the issue of a district exiting. And our initial guidance on this is that they see essentially a break even between the Union High School allowing them to exit with no payment to them for their relinquishing their share of the asset in return for them saying, well, we'll offset the value of our interest in the asset with the amount of debt that's still owed on the building, which is, I think, about $12 million, you know, which is part of a big $55 million improvement. So our initial guidance on this is that the recommendation is that essentially there would be a wash in that the reassignment of remaining debt to the remaining members is offset by the increase in their asset that they own, you know, having fewer claims against the asset. So we don't see anybody cutting anybody a check. It kind of gets to your other question.
But at this point, will we be paying a bigger check because there are only four entities at that point?
No, and that goes to the bigger question of where are those students? And as long as those students are still at BUHS and now Vernon is cutting a check for $14,000 or $15,000 per student, that revenue is going to offset the current debt. It's, you know, the current debt is not going to go up.
Right.
So it's an offset there. So it's a wash.
Kim?
Well, I was just about to ask what the impact on the individual taxpayers, what the increase was, but obviously if it's not being increased.
We don't see it as being an increase. We see it as
the remaining members. Now, do Vernon's taxes go off?
Vernon's taxes, the main issue for Vernon is they don't get the benefit of these initial transition support provisions of the act, right? So the unified system gets the benefit of a 8 cent tax credit. That's $80 on a $100,000 house. They don't get that benefit. So that's definitely a cost to them. But their basic operating expense, we don't see being substantially different.
So what is the plan now for Vernon should they leave? What are they planning? At one point, we've talked about them going ahead and staying in for professional development and supervisory union services, busing, and what was the other one? Special ed. So they would not, but then we heard that they would not be allowed to have that from the state?
That needs to be determined by the state board. In theory, we would have a meeting September 20th to review these articles and also their exit. The state board would have to make a final determination on that.
So whatever the state board says, though, economically, it's not going to impact the remaining members, it's going to impact her.
Right. So we see. Mm-hmm. And it comes down to, do they get assigned to another supervisory union because obviously they need the services, or is there this ability to make an arrangement with the new unified district for an equivalent service, but it would be for a fee. It would be a,
so I guess there is an economic impact to us if they're paying us for those services.
Right, we would have to invest in the resources to respond to whatever they're asking for, and that would have to be a break even, as you say, to the new union. It would not make sense for the...
Although now, if you divide out the professional development cost and everybody in the supervisory union is giving it together and we give it to less people, we're actually paying more.
Could
without Burnham.
But a lot of that is funded through the Title I, the Consolidated Federal Grant Program, so that's where it's actually...
Not such a big concern.
Right.
And Frank did a draft for Vernon, just to show them what the hypothetical looked like, and, it was reasonable. It didn't hurt the supervisory district, the other towns. It didn't have a huge impact on their tax rate. It had some, but not... I think it's 2 cents.
Right. The main thing is they just didn't get the benefit of the unified incentive, which means when you compare them to the union, they're paying 8 cents more, the 8-9 cents more than they would have if they stayed in the union.
And then Vernon would also not have any. They would be sending children without any representation on the board and any voice and any decision making, which they already do, I guess, to Pioneer, because and Marlboro already does that.
For Vernon, that it has been 20% of their students, secondary students. But if this whole thing goes through, then it will be for 100% of their secondary students. No representation on a board. Now it's 80%. With a rep on the BUHS board for those BUHS students.
Other questions?
Just to go back to Deb's question, Article 11. Whoever has it. The thing about EES, on Article 11, it talks about the exercising authority of the new district that would essentially take over any of the other authority.
So you think it's covered? It doesn't have to be more explicit.
It is covered. I knew it was, but it doesn't say yes, but it's in there. Okay.
Other questions? So the main reason that I put this on the agenda for tonight is because a lot of the study committee members feel that the law specifically stated that the boards, all the school boards, would get a chance to review it one final time before it would actually be sent to the state, and that vote is tomorrow night. And any comments that you all have, could still be put into this document, you know, discussed and potentially put in as of tomorrow night before we do a vote. And that's the other reason why we're having a community forum, because I felt like I had said that we were going to do that one more time for the public. So I don't know if any public's coming and cares right now, but. You might want to look at the process overview and the timeline, just so everybody understands that too. I say we look. I think there's, is there anything in the back of here? No, right. So in the presentation that we're doing, we talk about that. But essentially, this would be tomorrow night. The Act 46 Study Committee would be voting on it, whether or not to send it to the State Board. The State Board would have a meeting on September 20th to, as Ron was just explaining, talk about Vernon as well as our specific articles of agreement. The State Board has, not the State Board, but I guess the legal counsel and the Secretary's office have seen these drafts and given comments back and suggested changes throughout the process. If it went through then on September 20th, then we would be scheduling for our Brattleboro Board to be giving, in conjunction with the Act 46, be giving some sort of a, or I guess maybe it's the Act 46 Study Committee would be coming to give presentations at each of the towns. So just the board could have any feedback on times or whatever on that, but the study committee would be actually responsible for presenting that information. And that would happen in October, end of September, October, and we had a tentative?
Yeah, we have a range from like October 4th through November 2nd.
And didn't we give a tentative?
I don't know if your group actually said do it on this particular night. I don't have one.
I thought we did, and I think it was after, later in October.
So, what, in theory, what you try to do is maybe align it with the board night? You don't have to, but.
So, like the 19th?
So, the October 5th?
No, I'm not kidding.
19th?
I think we said the 19th. Does that sound? Mark, do you remember when we said for us? I'm thinking October 19th.
Hang on a second.
Sometimes I do.
I have that date listed, October 19th, so it must be, it doesn't say Brattleboro Town, but we could plug it in.
I think that was it, because I'm not here. So then,
6 o'clock.
Yep. And then we would actually, where are we going to do that?
Over the Academy.
Academy? Andy, is that all right?
There's a date.
October
19th. It'd be our second board meeting night, and then we just. And then the vote would be on November 8th. Should the vote go through and be approved, then it would go to budget process. The vote is actually a three-part vote. It's to approve the articles or approve the merger between all the towns besides Vernon and the dissolution of BUHS, letting Vernon leave, and the board members have to be voted on by law at that same time.
So if anybody wants to run for that board, you need to get the petition at some soon time.
Yep.
And then after, so that would be going through, and then we would be, he has it here too. But then the thing that we realized when we're putting together the presentation, so that unified board would have representation, but they don't really legally take over until July 1st. So the unified board and our board would be going through the budget process.
Yeah, our year would be the same as it is anyway.
Yeah.
Legally, we're still
until, well, it would be a little bit longer, I guess, because you wouldn't be done in March. It would be done July. And then, so, but the thing about this that the study committee talked about that was good, that we would have the current boards a part of that first year's budget process, along with the newly voted in unified board. And also, there was some concern that it would be good to have Ron still helping with the budgets and not having just a unified board that's brand new, and a new superintendent as well. So that in March, when you come around to the actual town meeting, there would still be town meeting representation night, or town meeting information night with the representatives. And our board would be presenting that information, but you would not be looking at just the Brattleboro Town budget. It would be part of the total budget of $54 million, right?
Mm-hmm.
Without Vernon?
That's right.
And the town meetings would no longer be voting on the budgets as they have in the past, and the town representatives would no longer have the sole authority over that budget. It would go to the entire town as an Australian ballot. And that would happen already in March. And then should it all go through, July 1st becomes a legal entity, the Brattleboro Town School Board would cease to exist and the Unified School Board would take over. Looking puzzled at me. Anyway, so we have 10 minutes before perhaps people will be here to hear about this. What's that?
Yes.
Are we moving? We're going to go out there. Yeah. Do we need to actually have a vote from this board whether to send it forward as a recommendation to the study committee?
That would make sense.
So, yeah, at this point.
Wait a second. The study committee is the one that votes on it.
Right.
Exactly.
We have nothing to say about it.
Well, the other boards, in our case, we have three people that are going to actually place their vote, so it's the majority of our actual mm-hmm. board anyway. But the other groups have all taken it back to their boards and wanted to have their input and an actual vote whether their boards supported it.
Well, before we do that, I'd like to... I didn't mention these things because I don't think they're, I know they're not going to change, but I wanted to, Judy Davidson sent us a letter today which really articulates my concerns. So
yeah, and I responded to that.
Yeah, I'd like to just share read the sections because they really articulate probably better than I can mm-hmm. the perspective. Well, she mentioned she's concerned about the articles and she's unable to inform it, but she did. Read the changes and is aware of what's being proposed and the rationale. First of all, I do not see how this merger will accomplish the estimated savings. Many of the items mentioned, fewer audits, fewer school board salaries, one budget, are minuscule, and the one potential savings, estimated $1 million, is in a lower student-teacher ratio and flexible staffing. Yet there's no description of how this will happen, which schools will be involved, and which teachers. Could this happen with collaboration among towns without the need for a merger? Moreover, towns have promised that there will be no school closings in the first 5 years, and I do not see how major savings can be achieved if we still have the same number of school buildings and capital expenses. Also, one of the other goals of Act 46 is increased education opportunity, which we are told will likely mean increased programming for some schools. However, there are no details of which kind of programming is needed, why, and whether extra transportation and staffing will be required. We're told that we need to think of the needs of the children, which makes it difficult to raise financial questions without seeming like a person who doesn't care about children. Yet I think it is responsible to get answers to the financial ramifications of the merger before we vote on a structure we are locked into. Moreover, what will happen to new programs after 4 years when the state funds for transfer costs dry up? As members of the Brattleboro Town School Board, you have worked hard to provide the best programs for our children while keeping in mind the concerns of taxpayers. I applaud your efforts. If you have concerns about this merger and how it will affect Brattleboro children and taxpayers, without necessarily achieving the Act 46 goals, asked for a vote on the merger to be delayed until all the financial details are spelled out and until other ways of meeting the goals of Act 46 are explored. And my perspective is without that, without those details, without any evidence, just relying on research report ratios, which call for elimination of 9 high school teachers and half of our nursing staffs, I think we need a lot more information, a lot more specifics of how this is going to happen. So I would encourage vote against it, at least for us to, I'm going to vote that this is not in the interest of the taxpayers. We don't have enough, or the children, we don't have enough information. And we're being asked to approve something that has way more ramifications than we can begin to understand.
Okay, so we should actually have a motion and then we can have further discussion. We need to have a motion to send or not send this to have our group voting on it and saying yes.
I move that we not send it to the not recommend it to be sent forward.
No, that would be the way to merge the motion. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there a second for David's motion?
Could you just repeat it?
I move that we not send the articles to the state board.
That's not what we're voting on.
Right.
We're voting on whether
we recommend that the study committee send.
We recommend the study committee not send.
Not send.
And then Mark is seconding
it? I'll second his motion.
Okay, any further discussion?
Well, but yeah, I'm unclear. So if we say that we don't recommend, we're essentially talking to ourselves, right? It's, the three of you would go tomorrow and say we vote against sending it? Or
we're not bound to follow what this board says, I don't think.
Well, this is basically asking us to endorse this.
As it
so if you think
right
it's
now.
If you think it's great, then you should vote for it. If you think it's not, then yeah.
But his question is, beyond making a statement, does it have any ramifications for what Mark, Kim, and I vote tomorrow?
That's what I'm specifically asking. If I say, yeah, I recommend that you don't recommend it, I mean,
you agree with Mark, with David?
If I say that, then it doesn't necessarily influence how the three of you vote. Is that true?
My understanding, but I guess I don't know.
Well, I'm thinking that if it was 3-2, 4, or 4-1, 4, that we would have to report out that the board did not recommend at this time that this be sent forward to the state. If it was 3-4 and 2-2, then we could say the board recommended that we.
I think in either case, we're going to convey the information to the Act 46.
Yeah, sure.
The fundamental question is if we are bound to follow this vote, and I believe that's been asked specifically by other board study committee members, whether they need to have their board's approval and if that is held. And I believe the answer was no, they don't have to follow.
That's a basic democratic question, whether you vote your conscience or you vote your board, and it's up to you. It's a personal decision. You decide whether that one matters more.
So your answer is that it's a statement. I guess it's more than just a statement because I feel like we're bound to present the concerns and the questions
right.
to the larger committee.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Whether we actually vote through or not would still come up for our own conscience. So for example, we could take you could say no tonight, we could take it to tomorrow and say no, and here's the reasons why, and share this letter and say that was the board's opinion and that we feel strongly that we need that information. And then come back, see what the study committee comes back with. Okay. I will state, I believe, that if we don't vote tomorrow night, we do not have time to get it on the ballot. And it would have to be a special election as opposed to being combined with the existing planned election.
In November.
Right, the beginning of November, because they only meet once a month. So if we miss a September meeting mm-hmm. for the state board, then we'd have to go to an October meeting. And then you couldn't have it on the ballot for November 8th if you don't hear back from the state board until after October meeting.
Provide time to answer some of those questions.
So it would necessitate a special election. It would also mean that the budget process would likely be done without a superintendent that's experienced, and would, if everything did, because in order to qualify for those tax incentives, you have to hit that July 1st date. So you would almost, if you're looking at, say, a March election, you would already be past the budget, and your unified board then would come into effect, and your other boards would cease to exist, and the budget process would be, you could say that they have to keep going on, I guess.
Or you could have a special election in November or December or January or February.
We wouldn't have it November. That would be gone because of the timing. More discussion? We could also postpone and table this vote until after we do the presentation and actually have the rest of the community forum part. And I think some of the questions that Judy asked are answered in the presentation.
I move that we table the vote until after the community forum.
So I think we need a second on that. Yes? Am I wrong with the parliamentary thing? Is there a second or anybody else?
All right, I'll second it. I'll hear some more arguments.
All in favor of the motion of tabling our vote until after the community forum?
Aye.
Any abstention? No, any opposition?
Okay.
So, then let's move us out there because supposedly people are out there now. And we haven't officially adjourned until we get them. So that's where we were at. We now come back to untabling the vote. I forget if I have to have some sort of a motion to bring it back up again.
Can I move that we take it and we reintroduce the motion as temporarily tabled?
Somebody second that?
Second.
All right, so now discussion on the motion, and the motion, David, was to
here,
not.
Here, I have it.
Thank you.
To not send the articles to the state board. That BTSD not vote to not send the voted to not send the articles to the state board.
Wasn't there something more about until further answers are, mm-mm, or you just
nope,
said
that was it.
Okay. So any discussion on that?
So if we vote yes, we're voting to not recommend.
To not approve. But it wouldn't influence what the voters, it will influence, but it's not.
I'm just trying to get clear on the wording. If we vote no, we're saying recommend.
Right.
Yes.
If you vote no on the motion, you're recommending. If you vote yes on the motion, you're saying no.
Great.
Okay, so is there more discussion?
I don't vote.
Is that allowed? I don't know what parliamentary procedure is.
Well, I'm not.
You're public.
I'm public. That's why I'm sitting over here now.
Go for it.
If we don't send this up to the state, all we're doing is kicking the can down the road. We're going to just go back and discuss it more and tweak it more and send it up later on.
We want to consider any other options. Something came along today. At least it's the first time I saw it. And this is from Mr. Savage, the clarification on Act 46 size requirements. And they talk about not required, so they're not requiring 900 or 1100, but down lower they talk about the transitional assistance that Act 46 provides. Act 153 and Act 156 process, residents side by side, et cetera. We talk about that. Note that it is possible to obtain a waiver to the size criteria under which incentives are available in Act 153 and 156. They didn't talk about that before. But that was not considered when we talked about side-by-sides. And the other thing they talked about is the final state plan issued by the State Board of Ed in 2018 will merge previously unmerged districts only to the extent necessary to achieve the goals and only if it can do so while maintaining each district's operating tuition-paying structure. X 46 does not require the district created in the state, and the final state plan be of any particular size. So they're already sort of moving back a little bit and flexing and trying to make it more manageable for people that are having issues.
Okay, so
I think and that and the fact that they finally have come along with some real description of what's involved in being an alternative and the data and the things. And it is a steep, it's a high bar. The regular version, there's no bar. And they're never going to look at whether this works or makes any difference or whether any of the things in this really remarkable plan are come to fruition. That's not going to be tested. But this, they're saying that there is this alternative. People can stay in their governance structure. They can't stay inequitable. They still have to meet the goals. And let's look at ways to meet the goals. And there are ways to meet the goals.
And that's exactly what I want to do. That's what I think we should do. And I think the proper way to go about doing that is to put the question before the people, do we merge or do we not?
I don't have a problem with putting that vote before the people. The problem I have is having this board say that we think this, because when we say, either we say yes, we want it to go forward, or no, we don't. What that looks to, for anybody that hears about Brattleboro Town School Board, voted to send it forward. Which means that if people read that to say, we think this is a good idea, we think this is the answer, this is the proper and the best way to go. And I don't think that that's the
case. Which is why we need to be very vocal if we don't think it's the way to go, as I was here today, and say, yeah, I don't think we should merge, but this is the best merger we can come up with if you want to merge.
Right.
So that's
I don't think this is the best proposal. I think that alternative structure is very doable, very viable, particularly since we've consolidated practically everything on this schedule.
See, I think the alternative structures are, to me, the question is merge or don't merge. That's what we're at.
Yeah, and I want to merge. I want to keep these local boards in control. And I think that this, because it's been such a difficult process, and because so many of these questions and some of these the board, the voting, all of those things are so complex and so convoluted because it's a badly considered law. And that the legislature, the new governor, the new legislature is going to be making adjustments. Everybody has said that. And to charge forward with this right now, the other thing that's very likely to happen is that they'll push that next July deadline back. And we'll know that in January or February because that will happen quickly. Otherwise, it's meaningless. And if they do that, then we don't even have to worry about losing the money. But if we charge ahead and do all this right now, it's done, it's gone, never mind what the legislature does or what else changes.
But Dave, what if they don't move it back?
Then there still is plenty of time to pass it before July. All you have to do is pass it before July.
Right, but you still have your budgets you have to deal with.
There's a year to do the transition. The same year that you have now, you have next year.
Okay, more discussion? Ready to vote? I think we do a roll call vote because then we can be clear, right? So remind me again, no to Dave's motion means moving it forward. Yes to Dave's motion means holding it back, right?
Yes.
So, Kim?
No.
Todd?
No.
Dave?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
No. So 3-2, right?
That's how it works.
It's 5.
That's how it works.
Okay, so we'll take your concerns, though, David, up. And Mark, since you're voting the same way, you can speak to that tomorrow.
Okay. Can we just maybe add to the soul that, much as Ian said, I'm against the merger, but if we have the merger, that's the best thing we've got. And we have reservations as to guidelines that have come out after this process even started, based on a legislature that does not necessarily seem to know what they're doing. And with the possibility of the new government, with a new government, there may be significant changes to our basis.
So I think you say that tomorrow.
Sure.
Okay, so then we need a motion to adjourn.
Nobody
Second, somebody?
Second.
All in favor, stand up and walk out the door.